Years ago, when I was working in South America, I gave a lot of retreats. And one of the sisters told me a story of a convent of very fervent, prayerful, mortified, and obedient nuns. But the mother cook made a complaint. She said, someone is taking food without permission, because we have vows, and one vow is obedience to eat during the scheduled time. So mother superior said, that's probably just a figment of your imagination. All the nuns here, they're very obedient and very mortified. But a week passed, and the food was disappearing from the kitchen. And the mother cook was complaining to Mother Superior, the food is disappearing. So Mother Superior decided that night she would go into the kitchen and hide behind the refrigerator. So lights were out at 10 o'clock and Mother Superior was hiding behind the refrigerator at 10 o'clock. Nothing. 11 o'clock, nothing. At 2 o'clock in the morning, the oldest, holiest sister, Matilde, sauntered into the kitchen, and Mother Superior was behind the refrigerator, and Sister Matilde opened up the refrigerator door, and she was gorging herself and stuffing food in her pockets. Mother Superior was actually scandalized at this unseemly conduct. So from behind the refrigerator door, Mother Superior said, "Be careful, be careful, be careful. I am the devil." She said, "Thanks be to God, they thought you might be Mother Superior." Heard a story of a couple of baseball players. They were good Catholics. They were in their 90s. And they're asking whether or not there's baseball in heaven. So they made a deal. Whoever died first would have to come back and tell the surviving player if there was baseball in heaven. Within a week, the oldest guy that was 98 died. About 3 days afterward, he came back and he appeared to his friend that was praying in his room. And he appeared to him and said, "Good news and bad news. Good news is that there is baseball in heaven. Bad news is you're pitching tonight." How about a California story? Sure. This is from the Orange County Register of, probably know that next to LA is Orange County, maybe you know that. It was a woman, she was married 4 times, but because she lost her husband. She was a widow 3 times. So the reporter was interviewing her on her husbands that were very different. First was a wealthy banker from New York, millionaire. The second was the head of Barnum and Bailey Three Ring Circus. The third was a Baptist minister. And the fourth was a funeral director. So they asked her, why? Why 4 different? She said, "One for the money, 2 for the show, 3 to get ready, and 4 to go.
You're blushing, Bob.
Maybe immigrants that don't know English don't know that really well, but it's a pretty good one, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
That was pretty good.
So I have a degree in English literature, theology, philosophy, and jokeology. It's a good one, right? Okay, good teachers will always start out by reviewing their last class, right? Right, that's good teachers will do this. So I'm gonna spend 2 minutes, maybe three, summarizing last class, and I wanna enter into explaining a couple of commandments tonight. So last night, can all of you hear me? Can you? Okay, good. Make me think of a story of a couple from the South. They were married 65 years. It was a cold night, and the old guy said to his wife, who was hard of hearing, she said, in the southern drawl, honey, you've been tried and true all these years. She said, what? Honey, you've been tried and true all these years. What? Honey, you've been tried and true all these years, and I'm tired of you too. She couldn't hear that well. So to make a good confession, 5 steps. You remember? Examination of conscience. Sorrow for sin, remember? Contrition. Third, firm purpose of amendment. Fourth, confess your sins to the priest, number and species. And fifth would be to carry out the penance. So those are the 5 steps to make a good sacramental confession. Okay, I'd like to start off with what Our Lady of Fatima said. You know, Our Lady of Fatima appeared 6 times in 1917. Did you know that? To 3 little children, Jacinta, Francisco, and Lucia. Did you know that? And they were canonized, the 2 of them, about 1.5 years ago, the 100th anniversary of the first apparition. They were canonized by Pope Francis in Portugal, Jacinta and Francisco. Maybe some of you don't know that Jacinta had subsequent messages that the Blessed Mother gave to her. So I'd like to mention about 3, and that'll be the diving board of my talk. Are you listening?
Yes.
Okay, the first is, she said, this is 1917, many, many marriages are not good. This is 100 years ago. Many marriages are not good. What she was saying indirectly, they're not based on the love of God. Second, she said, there will enter into the world many fashions that will gravely offend God. Fashions, what does that mean? Hollywood, okay? Hollywood. In other words, ways of dress that will gravely offend God. This is Mary, 100 years ago. July 13th, she appeared and showed a graphic vision of hell. And she said this, most souls are lost. They're lost for all eternity because of sins against the 6th and 9th commandment. You hear me? So the sins against the 6th and 9th commandment, which means sins against the virtue of purity. So that's going to be my topic tonight. I'd like to talk about that all-important topic. and beg for the grace to be able to live out Matthew 5:8, which is, blessed are the pure of heart, for they will see God. It's one of the 8 Beatitudes. So what I'd like to do is, I want to give you a catechesis on the purpose of human sexuality, because there's so much confusion today. We've never lived in a world with so much information, but we've never lived in a world with so much confusion. And I think there's more confusion than information. I repeat, we've never lived in a world with so much information, the internet, right? But we've never lived in a world with so much confusion as today. So what I'd like to do is this, divide it into two parts. Most of what I'm going to give you is taken from the Catechism of the Catholic Church. Okay, the Catechism of the Catholic Church. And I'd like to talk about what are the offenses against the virtue of purity or chastity. Because if we want to go to heaven, we have to try to attain purity. And that means not simply sexual purity, but that's obviously included. Purity of eyes, of mind, of memory, of emotions, of heart, of body, even of intention. Okay? Even of intention. This, I believe, is where the devil has the biggest inroad is in this very demanding virtue. So all of us have to beg for this virtue. It's a supernatural virtue, like humility and forgiving our enemies. We can't do it without God's grace. None of us can live the virtue of chastity without the grace of God. You hear me? Don't kid yourself. Don't kid yourself. None of us. But with God, all things are possible. Amen? Without God's grace, forget it. But with God's grace, all is possible. So let's go through the catechism, and because there's so much confusion. I don't know all the texts and laws, but in California, it's one of the most liberal states in the country with New York. You probably know that. You maybe have visited California. There's a hospital in California called Kaiser Permanente. Okay? 5 years ago, it was legalized in California that you could enter into Kaiser Permanente a woman, and you could come out a man, okay? And get hormonal treatment and psychological treatment. Legalized in California about 5 years ago. And it's probably going to become legalized in other states too. I hope not. Who would have ever thought 50 years ago that a man would change to become a woman change to become a man? No? Something like a horror story, no? It's a horror story. And if you speak out against that person, you're seen as a racist in California, okay? It's called hate speech. You're seen as a racist, you're a bigot, no? So let's go through the different... First of all, sexuality is good if it's done in the proper context, with the proper person, with the proper sacrament, with the proper intention, and being open to life. Otherwise, we wouldn't be here. We didn't fall from heaven, like from a stork down the chimney, as they used to say back 50 years ago. It's not the way it happens, no? Not the way it happens. So here's the catechesis. Let's start with our thought world. Are bad thoughts sins? Okay, she said yes. It's a tricky question. Okay, I'll respond by means of a story. Okay, a man was talking with a priest, and the priest asked the man, "Sir, did you entertain bad thoughts?" He said, "No, they entertain me." Okay. Got that? It's a good one, right? So if you can understand that humoristic anecdote, bad thoughts are not sins unless we give consent to them. As everybody has bad thoughts, we will have them until we die. Did you ever read the life of St. Anthony of the Desert, written by St. Athanasius? Got to read it, yeah? I did it as a tutorial at Villanova about 40 years ago. But fascinating. St. Anthony of the Desert lived to be about 105 years old. He went to live in the desert. He had temptations against chastity for a year. A year. Then our Lord appears to him, and he said, "Lord, where were you?" And he said, "In the very center of your heart." Because he never gave consent to those ugly thoughts. So our life on earth, St. Ignatius, the two standards, las dos banderas, si habla español, okay? Our life is a battle. It's a battle. Okay, so let's go from our thoughts. How about our words? Let me tell you an interesting story. Have you ever read the life of John Bosco? You have to read about Alfrey, is about the best. He's an Indian priest. He wrote about 100 years ago. Alfrey, okay? Alfrey, SDB, which means Society of Don Bosco. Okay, John Bosco, like Thomas Aquinas, and like Fulton Sheen, they all had several things in common, but they all had a photographic memory. Yeah? Do you know that? Bosco had a photographic memory. So did Aquinas, and Fulton Sheen did too. Now, John Bosco, when he was a priest for about 35 years, he complained. He said that when he was a child, some adult in his presence heard a dirty story. He couldn't get it out of his mind after 50 years. Hey, your tongue, be very careful what you say. You hear me? Every word that comes out of your mouth, you're going to be judged, Jesus says. Kind of scary, isn't it? Kind of scary. Every word that comes out of this mouth, we're going to be judged on it. St. Paul says, say only things that people need to hear to edify them, right? So, our ears and our tongue. Let me ask you this. How could you tell a dirty joke or say vulgar words if the body of Christ, amen, on your tongue? Come on. Vamanos, pues. Come on. There's something wrong there. You receive the body of Christ on your tongue, and there's something out of whack, I think. Your tongue is the throne of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords? How can you say that? Because when bad words come out of our mouth, it's because we've got a dirty heart. Jesus said, from the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks, right? Hello? So, we're in Lent, right? We might have to polish our speech a little bit. Think before you speak. Think before you speak. You ever read the letter of St. James? We should be slow to speak and quick to listen. How many of you people here have two ears and one mouth? You got two ears, right? And you got one mouth, right? Aquinas says, listen twice as much as you speak. Okay, let's move on. Let's move on about the various sins against this very demanding virtue. How about our eyes? How about our eyes? Early this morning, I said in the morning session, this is the dynamic of the human person. What goes into the eyes goes to the mind. From the mind, it seeps into the emotions. From the emotions into the heart. And that's transferred into an action. The repetition of actions forms what's called a habit. A good habit is called a virtue. A bad habit is called a vice. And that forms what's called the personality, the person. And it ends up in your destiny, either heaven or hell. So eyes, mind, emotions, heart, action, habit, personality, your eternal destiny. So very important that we control what enters into our eyes. That being said, right now in this country, over the past 10 years, the biggest addiction in this country is the addiction to pornography. Okay? You hear me? The biggest addiction in this country is to pornography. Especially pornography online. 50 years ago, you'd have to go to a liquor store and pull out a Playboy or a Penthouse, huh? 50 years ago, right? The dirty old guys, you're grabbing one of those magazines behind the whiskey. Nowadays, it's just a matter of the phone, right? Boop. Here you have it. It's hard. Now, I know some of you are going to feel uncomfortable with what I'm going to say, but I'm going to let the bomb drop. How many of you have kids? Grandchildren? Do you think it's wise to allow your children and your teenagers that are 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14 years old to have a phone? Hello? I don't agree with it. Because put it on an Ignatian balance. Not to say that the phone is evil. It's neutral. You tell me a 13-year-old boy alone with a phone and internet, come on. Wake up and smell the coffee. I think a lot of parents are very naive. They're living in denial. That kid has got that for a week. He's got it by himself. Within 48 hours, he's going to get into something that's what? Pornographic. And according to an expert, the founder of Focus in the Family, James Dobson, maybe you've heard of him. I mean, he's not a Catholic, but he's got a lot of good ideas. He retired about 10 years ago. But I remember I would listen to Focus in the Family because you got a lot of ideas for the family. He said, if you're a teenager, especially a boy, you're so vulnerable when you go through puberty, that exposure to pornography one time can cause an addiction. Just once. And he says that that addiction is more powerful than addiction to cocaine. We all know someone that's gone through withdrawal from drug addiction, right? We all know someone probably in our family. More difficult to overcome that addiction than to get out of cocaine. I know it's a very delicate topic. I'm not a biological father, but I would talk a lot to my kids. I've been teaching confirmation for 40 years. I have a little bit of experience, no? And I work with the boys because basically in LA, the boys are abandoned. I don't know about in Houston, the boys, they're abandoned. Father's working, the mother's too busy, they're abandoned. So I've got them in confirmation. I talk with them, I give them advice, I tell them jokes, I talk about baseball, I talk about soccer, I talk about gang activity. I mean, I love the kids. I feel that I almost have to be their father, no? And you know what pushes us often into pornography? Can I use a bit of St. Ignatius? Can I? Desolation. You know what desolation is? Key Ignatian word. Desolation means you feel there's a lack of faith, lack of hope, lack of love. You feel kind of sad, kind of depressed. You feel discouraged. You feel disoriented. You feel that no one seems to understand you. You feel no one appreciates you. Your life is kind of a drag. Life is kind of hard. For boys, in that state, pornography. As a temporary release of pressure. So every time he finds himself in desolation, he has recourse to his phone or whatever, no? And I think we have to know this key Ignatian concept. All of us are tempted when we're in desolation. It may not be pornography, it might be something else, no? But that's our kryptonite. That's our weak point. I was reading once a book on this topic, and there was a story of a man that had a tough relationship with his wife. He was watching a football game, and during the half, went into his room, and he left the door open, and he was looking at pornography in his room, and his 8-year-old daughter entered and saw him watching pornography. She ran to the mother and told the mother, and the mother said, "Honey, our marriage is over." How many marriages are being destroyed because of that? And they separated. You know why? We're going to be talking about this later. A married man or married woman addicted to pornography, that's adultery. It is. It is. Adultery goes beyond the mere physical. There's the adultery of the eyes. There's adultery of the mind. There's adultery of the memory. There's the adultery of the emotions. There's the adultery of the affections. It goes way beyond. I think one of the most challenging biblical verses. Have you ever read the Sermon on the Mount? Have you? How different the Sermon on the Mount is than the Old Testament. You read it, you're shaking in your boots, really. So it's radical. What did Jesus say? You've heard it said, you should not commit adultery. But I say to you, what follows? Whoever looks, what? At a woman with lust in his heart has what? Hello? Has already committed adultery. This is Jesus Christ. It's not Father Broom. See how Jesus is raising the bar? If you read the gospel seriously, Jesus raises the more I read the gospel, the more I feel, what a challenge. And Colby would say, Maximilian Colby, live it without compromise, without diluting it. We dilute it. Well, we're Americans, 2019, have to adapt to the culture. Not Colby, nor Francis, nor Mother Teresa, but we adapt it to our own complacency, huh? We adapt it to our own complacency. So let's go through the catechism, okay? Let's move on. You listening? Okay. Listen, masturbation, it's wrong. You hear me? It's wrong. Psychology says, no, that's, do what you feel, okay? If you don't believe me, read the Catechism of the Catholic Church. Short paragraph, explains very, and we know it is wrong. It's self, you're not open to life with masturbation. It's egotism, it's selfishness. You fall into that, confess it, and trust in God's mercy. But if you study Sigmund Freud and the big modern psychology, no, if you don't do it, you're going to be a stunted, frustrated individual. You're going to be dwarfed in your personality. That's, in New York, that's called malarkey. Or baloney, huh? What does the catechism teach? Chastity, daily self-mastery. Catechism. Daily self-mastery. So for us to attain chastity, there's a daily struggle we have to go through. Daily self-mastery. Okay, let me, related to this, we're in Lent, right? Those who are my age, remember how seriously we took Lent? Giving up, fasting, I mean, it was tough. How many children today, they go through Lent, they don't give up anything? And I think if you have a child, 7, 8, 9, 10, never gives up anything, what's going to happen when he's 13 and puberty kicks in full gear? There's no way he's going to control himself. So you are teachers and parents, you got to form the character of the kids. If your kid really likes chocolate or Coca-Cola and he says no for love of God, you're building up willpower so that when the imperious passions of the tempestuous, tumultuous teen years descend upon him, the storms, he's able to hold off because he's got willpower. He's got willpower. See, kids today, they're always eating, you know, chocolate. They have no control. Either we control our animal appetites or they control us. We become a slave to our animal lower passions. So good parents, in this time, fasting, giving up something, and the kids see that. What have you given up for Lent? You're forming your children in the virtue of chastity. You got me? You hear me? Right? It's not easy. We like food. We like candy. I mean, my favorite day of the year when I was a kid, I loved Halloween, no? The kids would go out at 5 o'clock. I'd go out at 12 noon, okay? Because I love candy. I still do, no? I like candy. But you deny yourself like that, you're fortifying your will in the love of Christ. Let's move on. Okay, fornication. You know what that is? No? Half of you don't know what it is, okay? Fornication means premarital sex. That's wrong. Come on, Father, everyone's doing it today. I don't care, it's still wrong. Come on, Father, you're an obsolete fossil of the Middle Ages. Come on, wake up and smell the coffee. What are you, an advertisement from Geoffrey Chaucer's Canterbury Tales? Come on. It's wrong. Sexuality has its place between a husband and wife married in the church. Amen? Now let me take another step. How about permanent fornication? That's my own terminology. Know what that is? It's an epidemic. I arrived in LA 25 years ago and it wasn't that common. When I was a kid, I would never see it. Permanent fornication, what's that? Yeah, they're living together. They're living together. You know, and it's in New York, they see shacking out, huh? Living together. We have to see if we're compatible, Father. Have to see if we're compatible. Got to see we got chemistry. Chemistry. That's a New York expression. You got to get chemistry to see if we really, you know, we click, huh? I don't know about this parish. In my parish, tons of the couples are living together. And I go after them. I go after them. I'm like, well, the pit bull going after them, no? Because I live with a lot of Hispanics, no? So I had an idea. I know these Mexicans. I know these Mexicans. So this, I had this idea. So many are living together. What am I going to do? I got it. Our Lady of Guadalupe. Yeah. I'll have a group wedding. Boda comunitaria. Group wedding, huh? And I'll allow them to get married for free. Free of charge. Hey, gratis. Gratis. No? Another idea. I got it. Bumpa lumpa lump bumpa bumpa lumpa lump bumpa bumpa. No Mexicans here. Mariachi. Oh. Mariachi! Hey! Then I know what they're gonna think. Padre, queremos la fiesta la pechanga. So we offered them the banquet hall, which was the old church. And they had the catechists that prepared the meal for them, and they got the bishop to come. I got 50 couples. 50 couples. I saved them probably $250,000. They call me Megabucks Broom. But I was able to move them from a state of permanent fornication from 5 years to 50 years. You got to be as simple as dove, but astute as serpents. Yeah? I'm crafty. I'm wily. I'm astute. To save souls. Okay, let's move from fornication. And I think all of you have some family member that's living like that. Hello? Probably all of you have some son or daughter or grandson that's living like that. And I think it really hurts you to see that because you know that they're not happy. They're betraying God. They're betraying their religion. They're slaves of their passions. They're living in fear, right? Okay, next. Adultery. Now, you heard the word adultery, right? I once heard a story of this little boy. He was about 8 years old. And he was, he went to confession to the priest and he said, Father, I punched my brother. I stole candy from the corner store. I stuck out my tongue at my grandmother. I lied. Then the 8-year-old said, one more, Father, adultery. Adultery, 8 years old. getting younger and younger. 8 years old, adultery. And the priest said, adultery, what did you do? He said, I disobeyed the adults. Getting younger and younger, huh? Okay. Now, adultery means you are unfaithful to your spouse. And as I said earlier, that can be in many ways. The most obvious is physical adultery. But also adultery can be, it can be of the eyes. It can be of the mind. It can be of the memory. Often it happens that you're having a struggle with your husband or your wife. Your marriage is on the rocks. You're going through a tough time. What happens? Think about your old boyfriend, Luisito. Ah, oh, Luisito, Luisito, donde estás, Luisito? Where is Luisito? Or Romeo, Romeo, wherefore art thou, Romeo? In other words, you're daydreaming. You're daydreaming, you're rewinding the film of your ex-boyfriend or ex-girlfriend. You do it on purpose? That's adultery. It is. That's adultery. It's adultery. It's adultery. You're purposely, oh, where is Luisito now? Oh, there you are with your husband. He's 100 pounds overweight, snoring like a bear. He's got a bad breath that could kill a cow. There he is. Luisito, Luisito, where are you? Young, debonair, attractive, eloquent, muscular, and I'm sleeping with this overweight bear, huh? The devil knows how to work. He paints the bad worse, and he paints the prohibited as something very beautiful, very attractive, very alluring. Huh? That's the devil. The devil's he's the father of lies, right? Liar and murder from the beginning, John chapter 8, huh? So adultery. But how about this? Cyber adultery. Know what that is? Cyber adultery is you can commit adultery online. Yes. Text messages to a boyfriend of yours that's in another country. Un besito, okay. Sending a little heart, three hearts. How are things going? You're cute. No, those little things, it's not the end of the world, but it's wrong. You'd be saying that to your wife. her? Nah. Heard a story of a lady married for 25 years, and she told her husband, "What? You never tell me you love me." You know what he said? "I told you 25 years ago when we're married. If I change my mind, I'll tell you." if you don't cultivate your married life, then it goes down the drains, you know? In one of my talks, I said this, that when I was brought up and raised, we're nine, when my dad would leave every morning, he would give my mom a kiss. When he came back, he worked on Wall Street, he'd give her a kiss. Take the train to Hoboken, down Manhattan. So they'd always start off the day with a little kiss, and then he'd come back and kiss. I thought as a kid, why are they always kissing each other? But you know, I felt good, because I felt that they really love each other. I felt it was sincere. And a few years ago, I celebrated their Diamond Jubilee. You know what that is? Their 60th. And one of them, we're having a nice meal together, having a nice glass of wine and talk and shooting the breeze. And one of them said, I think it was Mom, you know, we never had any serious problem in 60 years. And Dad looked at, yeah. How many couples can say they never had any serious problems in 60 years? Most can't say in 60 days, huh? But really, I mean, they didn't always agree, but they really got along well. They worked together, they talked together, they joked together, they danced together. Had nine kids, right? 39 grandchildren. That's a big family, right? And when you have something like that, that's when you get the priest, because I don't have these huge emotional wounds. I mean, I just have good memories, no? There's a wholesome terrain where you can get a priest, no? A wholesome, happy environment. When you have an environment like that, vocations come to the priesthood, the religious life, no? So adultery. God bless you. The roof went up. Man, that was a biggie. You know what they say in German? Gesundheit, right? Well, the roof. But another type of adultery would be the young people know this word. We oldies, maybe we heard it. It's called sexting. You ever hear that word? Okay, the old people never heard it. It's called sexting, uh-huh. Where you send like a bad picture, like a girl in a bikini to her boyfriend. That's really common, you know? You know, I've thought about that often, young people. It's stupid, because once you send that, it goes viral. It's out there until the end of time. If you want to send your transcript to go to Harvard or Princeton or Yale, some of the big Ivy Leagues on the East Coast, you're not going to get in, maybe. They see the door, this girl is pretty risque.
It depends on how much your parents donate, though.
Oh, I see. Money speaks, right? As Teresa of Avila says, with God and money, we can do a lot, yeah? Teresa of Avila. Okay, adultery. Okay, let's move on. Okay, what I'm saying now is probably the most controversial topic after abortion, okay? After abortion. And it's this, I'll try to be as clear as possible. If you don't have clarity on this as parents, your kids are going to be lost. It's this, okay? The practice of homosexuality is wrong. You hear me? I repeat, the practice of homosexuality is wrong. Even though it was legalized by the Supreme Court, what, 4 years ago? Okay, now you're going to be fighting with your kids. If you've got kids or teenagers that go to public high school, they're going to hear the exact opposite. They're going to say, well, that priest, he's bigoted. He's living in the Middle Ages. But my defense is this. If any of you ever do public speaking, you ever take a course in public speaking, much of it depends upon the authority of the sources that you have. If you've ever done public speaking, the authority of the sources means this. If I start to give a talk and I say, well, Joe Smith said this, Well, Joe Smith happened to be my grandfather, but well, you know, Joe Smith is kind of a common name, right? Or Jose Garcia said this. That has no authority. But if I say, according to Aristotle, or according to Plato, not what you play with, but the Greek philosopher, huh? Or William Shakespeare says in Macbeth, conscience doth make cowards of all of us. Wow, that's Shakespeare, huh? Or if I say, according to Albert Einstein, that's a pretty solid scientific source, right? Albert Einstein? How about if I say, according to the book of Genesis? How about if I say, St. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 13 on love? How about if I say, according to Jesus and the Sermon on the Mount? So in defending traditional marriages, that's what we're doing, you have to rely upon the most authentic sources. And that is not Piaget or Skinner or Sigmund Freud, but Jesus Christ. Amen? So in defending the truth, you as believers, you have to start off with that. Genesis 2 and 3. What does the Bible say? God created man and woman. A man will leave his father and mother, not father and father or mother and mother, okay? A man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife. What God has united, let no man rent asunder. That's the book of Genesis. That's pretty clear, isn't it? It was Adam and Eve, not Adam and Steve, right? Was it Adam and Eve or Adam and Steve? It was Adam and Eve, right? You want to take the most powerful passage? Genesis 19. Know what that is? Okay, Genesis 19 is the most powerful. Abram and Lot. Lot was on the outskirts of two cities called Sodom and Gomorrah. Know what happened there? Sodom and Gomorrah, they were practicing homosexuality. And who came to visit the family of Lot? Two angels that looked like attractive young men. And those who were practicing homosexuality went to the house of Lot, was knocking the door because they wanted to have sex with the angels. So they knocked on the door and Lot said, "Don't touch them. I will give you my daughters." Because an infringement against hospitality was really serious for the Jews. And they said, "You're a stranger, you're going to teach us lessons." They broke down the door and the angels confronted them and blinded them. Then the angels said, "Look, come, get the heck out of Sodom and Gomorrah." The angels had to grab them by the hands and pull them out. "Don't look behind, otherwise." And what happened? The wife of Lot turned around, and she was turned into a pillar of salt. And what did God do? He sent down what? Fire and brimstone. And those cities were destroyed. Why? Because of the practice of homosexuality. You can't deny that. You can't deny that. So if you don't have clarity on that, we're lost. And the two things that are militating most against the modern American society, destroying the innocent baby and destroying the family. Destroying the innocent baby, we call that abortion. Destroying the family is promoting same-sex union. What is legal is not always moral. Abortion, Roe versus Wade, right? That's not, it's a law, right? How about Emancipation Proclamation? Slavery was wrong, but it was legal up until Abraham Lincoln, right? So I really, really invite all of you, it would merit a long, long talk on this topic. But I'll leave it at that. You all hear me? And I'm giving you what the Bible teaches. The Bible, the Word of God, is the most authentic source you have. Okay, let's move on to another topic which is almost just as controversial, but you have to understand it. A few months ago, Pope Francis canonized two saints at the same time. One was the first, we have some people from Salvador here, Salvadoreños, no? Romero. Oscar Romero, who was shot when he was celebrating Mass. Maybe you saw the movie Romero? Okay. He's also canonized with Montini, we call him Paul VI. Canonized together. Okay, the Pope before Paul VI, his name was John the 23rd. Angelo Roncalli. The late 50s, there was an invention called the invention of the pill. Called the pill. You know what the pill is? The contraceptive pill. So, due to the progress of science, the scientists wanted John the 23rd to study this so that people could use the pill so as to limit the size of families. And the biggest myth and lie, I'm not a sociology major, but I'm not dumb, is the myth was the population explosion, which is one of the dumbest myths I've ever heard. Did you ever fly in the plane? Any of you ever fly in a plane from here, maybe to New York or California? What do you see when you look down? 92% is brown and green. What does that mean? So only 8% is settled. And you know, all the people in the world could fit into the state of Texas. This is Texas, right? All the people in the world could, Patrick Madrid and Relevant Radio, all could fit into a county in Michigan. Michigan's pretty big too. So that's a myth, it's a lie. So they brought together, John the 23rd brought together a commission to study the issue so that people could use the contraceptive pill as a means to limit the size of families. So John the 23rd called the commission, and almost everyone in the commission favored it. But guess what? He died. He died. So Paul VI was elected as the new pope. And he brought together another commission. And almost everybody in the commission, there was doctors and priests and theologians that favored. It looked like Paul VI promoting the progress of culture and education was going to say that the human person could use it as a means to limit the size of families. But something happened. In that commission, there were three people that didn't agree with that. One was Paul VI. He didn't agree with it. Another one was a 48-year-old brilliant archbishop from Krakow. His name was Karol Wojtyla. You ever hear of him? You know who Karol Wojtyla was? Okay, that's John Paul II. Would eventually write the acting person in Love and Responsibility, which would be a philosophical explanation on the importance of the human person and his dignity. So what happened was, Pope Paul VI and Carol Wojtyla and another person, his name is the Holy Spirit, okay, he was there too, decided to write the most explosive encyclical in the history of the church. And if you want to be educated people, all of you should read and reread the encyclical Humanae Vitae, which means on human life. So Paul VI published it. And then the spiritual atomic bomb exploded. And the church was divided. That was the watershed moment in modern Catholicism, July 1968. Up to that point, priests basically agreed, now every priest is an island unto himself. You go to one priest, he says this. You go to another priest, he says another thing. The church is shattered. Okay? But that was the key moment. Well, give me a literary summary of the document, and all of you read it. I read it in 45 minutes. I read an hour. No, it's not long. It's only about 30 paragraphs. And it's Paul VI is a very, very, very clear writer. Okay, yeah? Very clear writer. I love the writings of Paul VI. This is what he said. Are you listening? Every conjugal act, every marital act between husband and wife, has to be open to the possibility of life. Therefore, any use of artificial means of contraception is intrinsically disordered. A philosophical word, which means it's, well, a mortal sin. Intrinsically means its very essence, the very nature of it, it's disordered. From that moment, the church divided. The sad thing is that most priests and bishops did not agree with it. Did you ever read the Winnipeg document? The bishops of Canada wrote a letter of defiance to the Pope that they would not accept it. All the bishops of Canada. No Canadians here, huh? Never has it been in the history of the world almost where a fervent country has gone from fervent Catholicism to paganism overnight as Canada. Now I've got French Canadian blood. Back 50 years ago, Canada was very fervent. I mean, you know, Quebec and Montreal, very fervent. You have St. André Bessette, who was canonized about a couple years ago, orator of St. Joseph. It went from fervent Catholicism to paganism overnight, and principally because of that. Who was the principal teacher at Catholic U? Charles Curran. Who taught before him? Fulton Sheen taught there earlier. Charles Curran was probably the most famous moral theologian in the country back in the 60s. What did he say? Well, it's not a dogma faith. It's not de fide. Therefore, if that's the case, you can follow your conscience. Oh, boy. What does that mean? Who on earth has a well-formed conscience? Nobody. In other words, he opened up the door to using that because it was not morally binding, it wasn't a dogma faith. And as a result of that, because of the moral theologians, the liberal moral theologians, almost all the Catholics started to use contraception. And probably most of you fell into the trap also. You fell into the trap of using contraception when you were a young couple, okay? Lying to ourselves. We can lie to ourselves. Well, that's the way it is. No. We already have three kids. You know, we have to use that so that we don't have the fourth and we'll end up by fighting. No. And what Scott Hahn says, we fell into cafeteria Catholicism. Know what cafeteria Catholicism is? You pick and you choose whatever you want. And then we have Cardinal Ratzinger, who was Benedict XVI, said that one of the biggest heresies in the modern church is the dictatorship of moral relativism. You hear that? The dictatorship of moral relativism. There's no such thing as moral absolutes, but rather everyone is a truth unto himself, and that's the United States. That's the United States today. I determine what's right and wrong. I determine my sexuality. I determine the size of my family. I determine if I'm going to be using contraception or not. And as a result of that, the church became divided. And that brings us to the purpose of sexuality. As the Pope speaks in Humana Vitae, there are two basic purposes. Human sexuality has its place only between a man and a woman. Hello? Between a man and a woman. But a man and a woman united through the sacrament of matrimony. Man and woman united in the sacrament of matrimony. And the two primary purposes are unitive and procreative, okay? Unitive. What is that? Union in love after you're married. But procreative. What does procreative mean? When you get married, you're open to having children. That's what procreative means. Procreative, you're open to life. I was reading an article in Homiletical Pastor Review, which is a journal for priests. And the article said this: why are there less priests in the country? And he pointed out this: because of the contraceptive mentality. If Mary and Jim had one child, but God wanted them to have 10 children, there's 9 children from which you can't choose. So given that we're having less and less children, there's less priests. Listen to this. My parents were married June 26, 1954. I am an Irish twin. You know what that is?
Oh, yeah. Me too.
I'm an Irish twin. So, my brother Mike was born March 27, 1955. That's 9 months and 1 day after my parents were married. Guess when the second one was born? I am 15 years old now. You know why? I was born in a leap year. Amen? Yeah. I'm celebrating my quinceañera. You know what quinceañera is? I'm celebrating next year is going to be sweet 16. Yeah. But I see that. The fact that my mom and dad said yes to life, well, I'm a priest. They're open to life. I live with a priest that is one of 13. 12 boys and one girl. And he has a brother priest in Argentina. Parents said yes to life, give them priests. So the contraceptive mentality is fatal. It's fatal. If it is such that you can't have children, You cannot have recourse to contraception. You have to learn natural family planning. Okay, it used to be called the Billings method. Now it's called the Creighton method, is the more modern. You should know that. You know, it's ironic. There are women, 30, 35 years old, and they don't know about natural family planning. I have to teach women their menstrual cycle as a celibate priest. I mean, it's terrible. It's ironic. You're infertile now, wait a couple of days, then you're going to have a dry period, it's going to be about 15 days, and then after that, how do you know? Well, not from experience, no. Haven't gone to Kaiser Permanente, no? Why? Because I read. My sister is a teacher. I consult people because, and it's kind of funny. Why should I be teaching a married woman about her menstrual cycle? That's terrible. You should know that. You should tell me, no? But it's a moral topic. It's like if I came out and I made the sign of the cross like this: Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Or I ask you, you ask me, how many commandments, Father? I think there's 8, no? I'm a dumb priest. I'm supposed to know the 10 commandments. I'm supposed to know the sacrament. If you're married, you don't know that. That's negligence. That's negligence. That's omission. We're not living in the boondocks of 1700. We're living in the United States. Every married woman should be aware of that before she gets married. She should do the course on NFP. Right? Yes or no?
Yes.
Okay, so in conclusion, for us to be able to live out the virtue of chastity, the big five. Are you listening? Got to pray. You got to pray. You got to beg for the grace. You got to pray. Many people do not have purity because they don't want it, okay? You got to want it. You got to want it. It's necessary to get to heaven. Jesus said, blessed are the pure of heart, for they will see God. You got to want it. You got to desire it. You got to beg for it. Number two is we got to practice penance. That's why we got Lent. We don't believe in safe sex, but sacred sex. We don't believe in birth control, but self-control, right? Yes. We don't believe in birth control. We believe in self-control that comes through prayer and penance. Jesus said, some devils will be cast out only through prayer and penance, right? Hello? Third is, you have to receive the Eucharist, the body and blood of Christ. The blood of Christ is rushing through your veins, rushing through your body, rushing through your heart, and the blood of Christ will give you purity. Number four is we all have to avoid the near occasion of sin. You say that when you make the act of contrition, right? He who plays in fire will burn. He who walks on the slippery slope is going to fall. And last, and this will be my topic tomorrow night. I always, as an oblate, I always have to end by giving a talk on the Blessed Virgin Mary, which is one of my favorite topics. Okay? Do you love Mary? Love Mary. So if you love Mary, she will give you that precious gift. Those are the big five. To practice chastity. Prayer. Penance. The Eucharist. Avoid the near occasion of sin. And finally, love for the Blessed Virgin Mary. If you're faithful to that, all of you will be able to live out that beautiful beatitude. Blessed are the pure of heart, for they will see God. And I'll pray that all of you one day, this will be my prayer, that all of you one day will be a precious jewel in the crown of the Blessed Virgin Mary, contemplating the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit for all eternity. Amen.
Amen.
In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of death. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Yep. So God bless you. Have a good night. We'll see you tomorrow, God willing, okay?